thanks for gathering our time. I'd like to introduce the dignitaries of the dais. I would like to introduce the dignitaries of the dais. On my right, Mr. G. Panneerselvam, Assistant Professor, Head of the Department of Tripoli. To his right, Dr. Sivachandran sir, Professor, Department of Tripoli, and our Honorable Chief Guest to deliver a lecture on power system analysis, Dr. Chitty Babu sir. I would like to invite him for an applause. Dr. Sivachandran sir will give a brief introduction about our guest. Over to Dr.
So hope you are able to present all of you. A very good morning to all of you. So on behalf of our well-up group management and our Cloud Principal, Dr. E. Adami, and our Cloud HOD, Mr. G. Panneerselvam, and on behalf of our dear faculty members and my dear students, I welcome Dr. B. Chitty Babu from University of Nottingham, Malaysia. And first I would like to introduce him. Dr. D. Chitty Babu has completed his BA degree in Madurai Kamaraj University. ME degree from Government College of Engineering, Tirunelveli, and he has completed his PhD degree from MIT Roorkela. And after his PhD, he has worked in MIT Roorkela as assistant professor. And then he went for his postdoctoral fellowship in Czech Republic. And few other universities in Europe. He has completed two postdoctoral fellowships. And after that, he has accepted the assignment of assistant professor from University of Nottingham, Malaysia. He has published a good number of research papers in reputed journals, in reputed research journals. And he is editor of IEEE Access Journal and a special editor of a Green Engineering Journal and several other journals. He is acting as an associate editor at various levels. I feel immense pleasure in introducing Dr. B. Chitty Babu to the gallery. Thank you. And one more thing I like to inform you is the very purpose of this meeting, that is very important. The very purpose of the meeting is to make the students to understand the subject of power system analysis. So nowadays the students are always motivated from the college side or management side or the teacher side, always motivated to mug up the things in the book like we are doing in the school, but it is not the actual fact. We should not follow like that. In the engineering curriculum, after you are entering into the college, you should read the subject towards understanding the subject. Okay, that is very important. So keeping in this mind, I just invite Dr. B. Chitty Babu to throw you some light on power system analysis subject. Thank
you. So first of all, I would like to thank you, Dr. Sivachandran, Head of the Department, the Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, Veltech Multitech. And it's my immense pleasure to see you all, young students, so who are studying the essence of Electrical and Electronics Engineering in the year 3. So my current the research interests are renewable energy systems. So still I'm quite familiar with the power system, I mean as what you are studying currently. Maybe I think you might have studied about transmission and distribution. And the power system? Yes. So hope you studied about the transmission and distribution. So further, you are going to extend your studies on power system, is the power system analysis. So the power system analysis, it deals with the power flow analysis, I mean the control of active and reactive power, I mean in terms of voltage and frequency control. As you are going to study about the power system stability, I mean how the system ensures the good transient response during fault conditions on the power system. And further, you are going to study about the fault in power system. Basically, the faults are classified into two types, symmetrical fault and asymmetrical fault. And further, you are going to study about reactive power compensation, so which is one of the most prominent areas in power system by using the FACTS devices. So with this analogy, I am going to give you an essence of power system protection, so which is one of the most prominent areas today in power system field. As we are going to have a term is called the smart grid. So how this power system ensures the reliability of service? There are two things keeping in mind. One is the voltage and the frequency. These two parameters are deciding the power system reliability and the power system security. I mean, the voltage is a deciding factor of power system reliability, and the frequency is a key factor of power system security. So these two parameters, I mean frequency and voltage, must be maintained within setting limits. As per our Indian standard, the voltage must be maintained within acceptable limit of plus or minus 5%. And the frequency must be maintained within the ranges from 49.5 to 50.2 Hz. So how your system, it ensures the constant voltage and constant frequency irrespective of the grid situation. Either the grid is under balanced condition or the grid is under unbalanced condition. And if we could talk about our Indian grid, basically the Indian grid is a peak grid. What do you mean peak grid? Voltage fluctuations are too much, especially in the countries like India. You can find the huge fluctuations of the voltage and frequency across India. Because of the fluctuations in voltage and frequency, the grid unable to maintain the stability. So it loses its stability, so that we can face the problem is called the blackout or brownout problems. To avoid such very abnormal conditions, we have to maintain the voltage and frequency constant, irrespective of the conditions of a grid, either balanced or unbalanced condition. So this power system protection, it ensures when the fault occurs in electric grid, then there is a sudden change in the voltage and frequency, it leads to abnormal condition of the grid. So how your system ensures the reliability of service during fault condition? So how the system, it ensures protection against such abnormal situations? So that's what the essence of power system involves. Just I am going to highlight what are the requirements for good power system protection equipments and how the relay is coordinating for clearing the fault. So there are two things you are going to learn from my lectures. One is the switch gear, I mean how the circuit breakers ensures to trip the faulty circuit, I mean to isolate the healthy network, and how various type of relays are involving in fundamentals of power system, I mean to provide the signal to the circuit breaker so that the circuit breaker can trip to isolate the faulty network from the healthy network. So two things we are going to learn. So the first one, we should discuss about the circuit breakers used in power system, especially on the fundamentals of power system. After having 5 to 10 minutes break, so let us discuss about protective relay. What are the various types of relays are involved in power system? Then further, I can give you an essence, what is today's power system? How the protective system is going to be modified in future power system? That I will give you as an idea. Okay? Yes. Next. Just I told the protection scheme had to discriminate between normal and abnormal system conditions. I mean, first of all, the protection system has to provide the discrimination. What do you mean discrimination? If the system is under normal working condition, it should not harm, it should not interrupt the reliability of service. Whenever there is a fault in the power system, the protective system immediately takes the responsibility to isolate or to prevent the electrical equipment. So the protection system has to discriminate between normal and abnormal working condition. That's the first requirement. And protection is achieved with the use of fuses or relays that control circuit breakers. Yes, very, very basic element we are using in our house is a fuse element. So fuse basically, it whenever there is an overload or whenever there is a sudden change in current, then the fuse will come to action. So it will trip the circuit. I mean, the fuse wire will be melted so that the faulty part will be isolated from the healthy network. So starting from the fuse, or we can have a modern fuse is what is called a circuit breaker. So the protection system achieved with the use of either fuse element or circuit breakers. And fuses are designed to simply blow to interrupt the current. Yes, I told you, whenever there is a overcurrent flows on the load, then the fuse wire, it will melt so that the overload will be avoided in the power system. So it will protect the equipment against overload. That is the basic concept of fuse element. The fuses and relays need to be coordinated so that unduly large sections of the power network are not disconnected. So while you are using the fuse in electric power system, it should have a good coordination with the relay network so that the continuity of the service has to be maintained and reliability of power system will be enhanced, and also the uninterrupted power will be avoided. So it has to have a good coordination. Yeah. Yes. Electrical apparatus, why we need protection? I told you, first of all, as we are electrical engineers, when you are going to work in industry, what is your main role? Main role is what? Reliability of service. You want to provide continuity of the electrical service. That's a major concern about the role of electrical engineers in the industry. So the protection system, why we need? Electrical apparatus operates at various voltage level. As you know that, I think you might be studying the transmission and distribution side. We are generating the power at the generating station at 11 kV. Then further it will be stepped up into very high voltage level for economy of power transmission at a very, ultra high voltage level. Then we are transmitting over long distances. Again, we have a substation to stabilize the voltage. Further, it will be distributed to the either industry or local consumers at either single phase or three phase voltage level. So your power system is operating at different voltage levels, first of all. So, and maybe enclosed or placed in open. Your power, voltage is available at a different voltage level. Under abnormal operating condition, the protection is necessary for two things. One is safety of electrical equipment, very important thing. So the equipment should not be affected at any cost. And second is what? Safety of human personnel. So if any unduly over voltage happens, it may harm to the operating personnel. So the protection is necessary to protect equipment and to protect human being. Okay? Yeah. And the protection is basically classified into two types. One is apparatus protection. What do you mean apparatus protection? If we are trying to protect the particular system, for example, transmission line protection, overhead transmission line protection and transformer protection. So if you are providing a protection system for a particular unit, is a transformer protection or maybe a generator protection, motor protection and bus bar protection. These all are coming under apparatus protection or unit protection. You are concentrating on a particular unit of power system equipment. And if you could talk about system protection, what do you mean system protection? Overall power system network. Out of step protection. What do you mean out of step protection means? While multiple generators are interconnected, as you know that, okay? So multiple generators are interconnected via common grid network. So your entire hierarchy must be protected, coming under system protection and under frequency release. I think you know one of the most very critical part in the electrical power system is what? Under frequency. When the system is operating at 50 hertz, when the frequency goes to below 50 hertz, can anybody tell? When the normal operating condition, grid is operating at 50 hertz. At which situation the frequency may go below 50 hertz? Yes. When the frequency will go below 50 hertz? You might be studied in transmission. Yes, when the frequency will go below 50 hertz? Sorry? So frequency is constant whenever there is a source and load is maintaining equal power. Okay? So the source is supplying 200 megawatts. If the load power is 200 megawatts, so if the source and load power both are perfectly balanced, then the frequency is maintaining constant. But when the source is 200 megawatts, when the load power increases, so due to load and source mismatch, it causes under frequency. So the frequency varies due to load and source power mismatch. Okay, so this is one of the most important criteria in today's power system. As your source power is constant, but load power goes on increasing. So due to increasing demand, although of course it causes under frequency. That is coming under system protection. So how you can protect the system against under frequency? Whenever there is a load and source mismatch. Then islanding system, that is especially under modern power system with the renewable energy and rate of change of frequency. Sometime what happen, whenever there is a fault in the power system, the frequency can change suddenly due to changes in the reactive power and active power is what is called the rate of change of frequency ruling. So these all are coming under system protection. So you have to ensure to provide the protection on the power system, either apparatus protection or system protection. And choice of protection scheme. How? What are the choices to provide the protection system? First of all, the protection system depends on size of the protection system, I mean the importance of circuit and required speed of interruption. That's a very important thing. I mean, whenever there is a fault in the electrical power system, and immediately the protection system should take the action. Because if the fault happens, if your protection system is making delay to take the action, it will collapse entire power system. There is no meaning of power system protection. Okay? So the choice of protection depends on speed of interruption. So how fast your protection system take action against abnormal situation. That's the important choice. So the protection system must ensure speed of operation. And unit scheme are used exclusively for bus bar and transformer protection. You know that as we are providing the unit protection system, this is exclusively suitable for transformer and the bus bar. You know, the bus bar is mainly provided in the substation to connect multiple generators are in parallel. So the bus bar protection is very important. So that also depends on the size of protection. And distance scheme has to be used for transmission line. As you know that, as we are transmitting an electrical energy over long distances, so whenever there is a fault occurs, for example, the fault occurs at 100 km far away from the generating station. So the distance protection is involving for protecting a transmission line, especially. So that depends on the, distance of transmission line. And overcurrent release tend to be used in distribution line. Let us come to the distribution side. Whenever there is an overload, or whenever there is a problem on the load side, how the distribution side, the overcurrent relays are placed to provide overcurrent protection. So these are the basic choices of protection system. Either it may be in the transmission line, or it may be in the unit scheme of bus bar or transformer, or it may be in the distribution side. These are the very important thing. See, while you are providing the protection system, it may not be unique in nature. Okay, that depends on the equipment and it depends on voltage and current rating. That's a very important thing. Okay, next. Very first I told you, the first form of protection is a power network is basically fuse element. And you can find the high rupturing capacity fuse on the right side. just simply having the conducting material inside, basically the lead oxide material. Whenever the current exceeds certain limit, then fuse wire will be melted so that your faulty network is isolated from the healthy network. Okay, this is the basic action of the fuse. But and each fuse will have a certain 20 values with them definitely having the type operation gives certain fault current. Actually, this speed of operation is however fast, but still it is not sensitive for fault. So if the fault is very sensitive, this fuse element will not take action. That's why you can find nowadays, because you can find this, the switch is what is called a miniature circuit breaker. Yes, you can see on the top. So the fuses are insensitive for faulty condition. So for having more sensitive production, we have the, I mean, switch is what is called the MCB switch. MCB, I mean, stands for miniature circuit breaker. So we cannot find the fuse nowadays, except the busbar on the substation, because this is insensitive during fault condition. So because you are deciding the fuse wire based on the current flowing through the wire. So the fuse wire dimensions basically design approximately 125% of rated current. So whenever the current exceeds 125, wire will be melted so that faulty network will be isolated. But if the fault is very sensitive, for example, frequency goes down, fuse will not take action.
So this is the information about the relay, I mean the fuse. It never work, I mean, when the frequency changes. Okay, this is the problem of the fuse. It is used only for overcurrent protection in the older power system. Nowadays you cannot find the fuse except busbar protection. You can find the fuse is what is called HRC fuse, high rupturing capacity fuse. It is only used in the substation, especially for busbar protection. Other than that, you can't find the fuse in today's power system. Even in our house, we have a miniature circuit breaker. It is very sensitive, even small fluctuation in the voltage, it will be immediately tripled. Understand?
Yeah, nice.
Yeah, what is the limitation of fuse? It is difficult to control the time of trip, I told you. So it can be designed based on the time of operation. So this is the difficulty of your fuse element. And this makes primary backup relay coordination difficult. So you cannot provide any backup protection. If the fuse is under trouble, what happens? Of course, you cannot provide any backup protection. That is the difficulty. And once fuse melt, it has to be replaced by another element. So there is an interruption of power. Okay? And it is difficult to have remote operation. It cannot be placed for distance protection. Understand? The fuse is provided only for unit protection, especially for transformers and busbar protection. It can't be used for transmission line or distribution line protection. Yeah, let us come to a logic element, which is one of the basic building block in the power system, is what is called a relay. What do you mean relay? A relay is a logic element which possesses the input, mostly voltages and current, from the system and issue the trip signal to the circuit breaker, first of all. So the current is coming from the transmission line and voltage is coming from the transmission line. The current is coming from the transmission line and the voltage is from the transmission line. We are giving the voltage and current to the relay network, and based on the current and voltage values, it will provide the trip signal. So relay is basically sensing element to sense the fault current. Understand? So it will sense the fault current that will be given to the circuit breaker. Next slide. Yeah, you can find here. So the current and the voltage is from the transmission line given to the relay network. Relay will it will sense the fault current given to the circuit breaker. So circuit breaker is basically normally closed switch. Okay? So that circuit breaker is a normally closed switch. So that whenever there is a fault in the transmission line, so the fault current will be sensed by the relay, and that relay is given to the circuit breaker so
that circuit breaker will be tripped. So that the faulty element will be disconnected from the healthy element. Yes, you can have an idea. The fault is created here. Yeah. The fault 1, fault 2 and fault 1 is created here. Now what happened? There is a fault in this transmission line. What happened? Sir. Oh, like this.
Contact in the circuit breaker. So then circuit breaker will be
failed during the faulty condition. So that is a very important thing. And nature, shape and separation of the electrode. How the electrodes are going to be separated during faulty condition. So these are the important, I mean, factors it will decide the arc phenomena between the two electrode and the circuit breakers. Yeah, next. Yeah, this arc is quenched by what? As two contacts are placed. If you are placing these two contacts inside the dielectric media. Now what happened? Your arc can be easily quenched. So arc quenching is achieved by greater dielectric strength than the restraining voltage and faster rate of heat removal than rate of heat generation. So you want to immediately recover the arc from the arcing phenomena, due to arcing zone. So these two are the arc quenching phenomena. And our extinction methods are basically, you can lengthen the air gap. Now what happened? If these two electrodes are separated during fall, if the separation is more, of course, the rate of restaking recovery voltage will be lower. So that depends on length of the gap and cooling the arc. So if you provide a cooling media inside, now what happened? If the switch is suddenly open, immediately arc produces the very high heat, it will be immediately quenched by having cooling media. You can provide the hydrogen inside. So hydrogen will cool the arc so that your arc will be vanished. Then inserting the media of high dielectric strength. If you have any kind of medium, for example, there is oil, or what you are using the transformer. So if you are using the medium of oil inside, oil is a perfect insulant so that it will quench the electrical arc during circuit breaker operation. Okay? Yeah. Yeah. Next. Yeah. Next. Yeah. The circuit breakers are classified into, based on the media, they are classified into oil circuit breaker, vacuum circuit breaker, air blast circuit breaker and SF6 circuit breaker. These are the four famous circuit breaker used in power system protection. Yeah. Yeah, if you can have an idea, the oil circuit breaker, as you have, this is the fixed contact and this is the movable contact. Now what happens during normal operation, fixed and movable both are touching. So both are normally closed. But whenever there is a fault due to the action of spring, this movable contact will come down. So that this both will be separated inside the place you are circuit breaker chamber. We have an oil, arc quenching part. So this oil, immediately it will cool the arc. So that your arc will be easily quenched at the time of operation. This is what is called the oil minimum circuit breaker. And the contacts are immersed inside the oil. Okay, basically we are using crude oil inside. So that it acts as a quenching media. So to manage the arc. And oil provides cooling by either hydrogen created by arc. Either even you can add hydrogen. Still it will enhance the dielectric strength. And it acts as a good dielectric medium and it quenches the arc. This is the oil circuit breaker. You can find this circuit breaker in the substation. You can find the voltage above 11 kV to 765 kV. You can find oil minimum circuit breaker. And the advantage of oil circuit breaker, oil has good dielectric strength. As you know that, the dielectric strength of the oil is above 30 kV per centimeter. So it's having good dielectric strength and low cost. Of course, it's very cheaper. As we have an oil, we are producing from crude oil of petroleum. And oil is easily available. It has a wide range of breaking capacity. And this advantage is what? Slower operation. So the response is very sluggish. That is the problem of oil circuit breaker. And it is highly inflammable, so high risk of fire. Sometimes it will create a fire accident inside. So that, your contact will be burst sometime. So this is the problem. And the high maintenance cost. Because every 6 months you have to check the dielectric strength of the oil. Because slowly the oil, it acts as quenching media, slowly it will lose its dielectric strength. Maybe after 6 months, you measure the dielectric strength. It may reduce from 25 kV per centimeter to 20 kV per centimeter. So slowly it will lose its dielectric property, then there is no usefulness of the oil. Okay? So it needs a frequent maintenance. That is the problem of oil circuit breaker. Yes. Another one important circuit breaker is what is called the vacuum circuit breaker. As it's having the voltage range from 3.3 to 33 kV and is having the high vacuum pressure inside the chamber. As you can find the electrode fixed and the mobile contact, in between the vacuum is placed. So the vacuum can act as a quenching media. So that whenever there is a bond, then the arc is formed between the electrode, it will be quenched by vacuum circuit breaker. Yeah. And it's a free from argon hazard, as it's the main advantage, and low cost for maintenance and a simpler mechanism, and low arcing time, that is the advantage. So the response, the speed of operation is very fast as compared to oil circuit breaker. And of course it's a very silent operation, it cannot provide any audible noise, and due to vacuum content remain free from any corrosion. So it do not produce any corrosion, so it needs less maintenance as compared to oil circuit breakers, and no bypass product. It cannot produce any CO2 emissions or any carbon monoxide. So that it is a very green, and it is friendly circuit breaker. And this advantage is what? Capital investment. So capital cost is very high as compared to iron circuit breaker, and also size required for high voltage breaker. As the voltage range is very high, then the size of the circuit breaker is very high. Okay. So this is the disadvantage of vacuum circuit breaker. Next time. And another one circuit breaker is what? Air cast circuit breaker. I mean, as the fixed and moving contacts are placed inside the air media, so that if the air is forced inside, so that it will act as a dielectric media to quench the electric arc during faulty condition. Okay? This is what is called the air cast circuit breaker. Yeah, you can find the chamber. So we are having air on the air receiver, so it will be forcefully provided inside the chamber, so that it will quench the electric arc whenever there is a fault condition. So this is what is called a air blast circuit breaker. You can find this is for 25 kV single phase air circuit breaker used in the substation. And the air blast circuit breaker advantage is a high speed, of course, as is having the air circuit breaker, speed of operation is better than oil circuit breaker, but still the response is sluggish as compared to vacuum circuit breaker. And ability to withstand frequent switching. Yeah, if the fault is frequently happens, still it sustains to quench the electric arc. And the facility for high speed, that's the advantage. The speed of response is excellent, less maintenance as compared to oil circuit breaker. As we are providing the air, so your frequent maintenance is not required as compared to oil circuit breaker. And this advantage is what? Little moisture content will be inside, so it may provide the response. It's a very slow rate. So the moisture content will be observed. Yes, what kind of material you can use to observe the moisture in power system? Silica gel, very good. So by using the small amount of silica gel, so it will absorb the moisture content, so that the response time is very low. So that is the disadvantage. And the risk of fire hazard, maybe it may cause the risk of fire during over voltages, because the over voltage phenomena occurs in the electrical power system mainly during circuit breaker operation, as the contacts are suddenly opened. So it may cause very high voltages during small time interval, is what is called transient over voltages. So circuit breaker is the main culprit for generating very high voltage during transient time. So that is the problem of air blast circuit breaker. It may cause dangerously very high voltages. So it may damage your circuit breaker contacts, and it can't be used for high voltage operation. I told you. So this may provide a very high over voltages during circuit breaker operation. It cannot be used for very high voltages. It may be used for only medium voltage substations. Next, one of the most famous circuit breaker is sulfur hexafluoride circuit breaker. As we have a chamber of sulfur hexafluoride gas, as it is having very high dielectric strength, so it can be used for very high voltage level. Maybe it is used in the high voltage transmission line. You can find SF6 circuit breaker. It is very more popular, SF6 circuit breaker, for high voltage transmission line. And for medium voltage and low voltage, still vacuum circuit breaker is very popular. Yeah, next. This is what is called the SF6 circuit breaker. As the fixed contact and the moving contacts are placed inside the chamber of SF6. So that when the contact is left open, the arc is formed, then arc will be quenched by SF6, sulfur hexafluoride. As it is having very high dielectric strength, immediately it will extinguish the electric arc. This is the SF6 circuit breaker. Yeah, next. Yeah, as I told you in this lecture, we studied about the basic concept of power system protection, I mean the unit protection scheme and the equipment protection scheme, and further we studied the choice of protection scheme, I mean the either transmission line or distribution side, or maybe a unit protection system like a transformer or substation, I mean the bus bar protection. And further we studied about the how, what is the role of relay and circuit breaker, and based on the arc quenching media, how the circuit breakers are classified. So they are classified into four types: oil, vacuum, air, and SF6. And from this, and most of the things, and we are using the SF6 circuit breaker, and vacuum is the most popular circuit breakers used in the power system, especially due to the reliable and fast operations. Okay, so these are the very fundamental informations on circuit breakers, and I think let us have a 5 minutes discussion, then further we shall discuss about protective relay. As we studied about circuit breaker, after 5 minutes let us discuss about protective relay. How relay is going to be classified, that depends on the type of fault, then how it is going to be operated, that we will see after 5 minutes. So any doubt regarding these lectures? Any doubt, please let me know, I will clarify your doubts. Yeah.
Okay.
But when your index supporter is heavily loaded, during that condition, relay should trip the circuit. So what I am coming to say, it may or may not be required. So relay is not necessary to trip the circuit during abnormal operating condition. Please understand, if the system is under overload, relay should not trip the circuit. But if the system is under faulty condition, relay should trip the circuit. I mean, should protective relay trip during normal or abnormal condition, it depends on severity of the fault. Please understand, the severity of the fault, the relay should take the circuit, should take the decision for tripping. So it may or may not be required to take cognizance of abnormal operating condition. So normal, overload condition, relay is not necessary to trip the circuit. Okay? And some example of abnormal operating condition. I told you, starting of large induction motor. So during starting of induction motor, starting current is very high. But once the motor picks up the rated speed, I starting current will be come to the normal condition. So during that situation, relay should not trip. Then induction motor never be started. Okay? So large starting of induction motor or any power swing, relay should not trip the circuit. So magnitude wise, this current may qualify as a fault, but there is no need to provide protection. Please understand. Next, thus the protective system must be able to discriminate between normal operating conditions and abnormal operating conditions. So relay should identify whether the system is under normal or abnormal. Again, if the system is under abnormal, whether the system is under fault condition or starting of large induction motor. So it has to identify the discrimination. That's a very important thing. Next. Yeah, it may or may not be required to take cognizance of abnormal operating conditions. I told you, and operating conditions will fall. Yeah, next. Yeah, you can find the zone of protection, external and internal fault. Yes. As let me tell you.
Okay, so the current flowing through this point and the current flowing through this point,
entering and leaving, both are equal. So if current flowing through and away from the relay, this is what is called the overcurrent relay. Okay? So the current entering is, for example, 1 ampere. Here current entering is 1 ampere. Now what happened? There is no difference in current, so relay will not take any action. Relay will not take any action as the transformer is working under normal condition. But whenever there is an internal fault, now what happened? The current flowing through this line and the current flowing through this line, both are unequal. Now what happened? If the current flowing this point and the current flowing through this point, if both are unequal, then this relay will take action. So this relay is what is called a differential relay. Okay, this relay is what is called a differential relay. So current flowing and entering are unequal, then the relay will take action. This is what is called a differential relay. So it has to provide the ring of security, is what is called a zone of protection. Understand? Yeah, next time. Yeah.
You can have an idea. Faults within zone are called an internal fault, whereas the fault outside the zone are called the external fault. The external faults are also called a throw fault. Now, ideally, a relay looking after the protection of zone should operate only for internal fault. First of all, the relay is looking only for internal fault. Whenever there is an external fault, relay will not take any action. So it has to have a good coordination. And the farthest point from the relay location is called the reach point.
Yeah, this point. For example, this is the relay zone. If the fault is here, this is what is called the, farthest point from the transformer. This is what is called the reach of the relay. If the fault is happening here, still it is a reach of the relay. So it has to form a ring of security with the long distance is what is called the reach of the relay. Next. Yeah, you can find. So the distance between relay location and the reach point is called a reach of the relay. It has to be properly identified. Next. Yeah. Overcurrent relay, first of all. What do you mean overcurrent relay? The relay will take action whenever there is an overcurrent. Whenever there is a current beyond certain limit. The most visible effect of fault is what? Sudden buildup of current, first of all. So whenever there is a fault in the power system, it will build up sudden rise in current. Okay? So if there is a sudden rise in current in power system, then you can identify there is a fault in the power system. Because most of the faults are basically what? Short circuit fault. So short circuit, it indicates sudden rise in current. So sudden buildup of current is what is called an indication of fault in power system. So relays are designed to identify the fault under overcurrent is called the overcurrent relay. So overcurrent relays are responsible for sensing the fault current during sudden rising current is called the overcurrent relay. And overcurrent relay is overcurrent relay is a relay to sense the fault current during sudden rising current. Now, however, the fault current magnitude is a function of type of fault and source impedance. And that is another one important thing. So the fault current magnitude, it depends on what? Fault current depends on what? Fault current depends on what? So current depends on what in power system? That's the thing I told you. So the fault current magnitude depends on type of fault and source impedance. So always systems should be designed with higher impedance so that the magnitude of fault current is minimum. Next step. The source impedance, which depends on number of generating units in service and keep changing time to time. Therefore, the reach as well as the operating time of overcurrent relay keep changes from fault to fault at any time. Why you are designing your overcurrent relay, the relay principle never be unique for different type of fault. So the relay principle is different for different type of fault. Overcurrent relay responsible only for overcurrent phenomena during fault condition. It cannot take any action for frequency changes. And it cannot take any action for power factor changes. That is a very important thing. So it is very unique in nature to take the actions during sudden buildup of current. Yeah, differential relay. I told you. The differential relay, what it will do? Differential relay will take the action whenever there is a difference in current flow. Differential, what do you mean? The current difference, it will provide the trip signal to the circuit breaker. So that is what is called a differential relay. So it is based on the premise that the current entering the potential zone section must be equal to the leaving. So current entering and leaving are unequal, then this relay will take action. But if the current entering and leaving both are same, it will not take any action. This is what is called a differential relay. You can find this relay is most suitable for transformer internal protection. Especially the turn, inter-turn part, this relay is most suitable for transformer and also for induction motor protection. Next. What do you mean distance protection? So distance protection is what? Relay is used in a distance transmission line. So especially for transmission line protection, this relay is most widely used. Because the type of fault depends on the distance. For example, as the distance goes on increasing, what about the impedance? As the distance of transmission line increases, what about the impedance of transmission line? It will decrease or increase?
Increase.
So, if the fault occurs at 50 km, fault impedance may be less. If the fault occurs at 200 km, the fault impedance is very high. So, based on the distance of a transmission line, this relay will take action is what is called a distance relay. I mean, the distance is directly proportional to impedance of a transmission line. So, is there any variation on the impedance, this relay will take action. Understand? Yeah, this is what is called a distance relay. I told you, the distance relay in FL, it measures impedance between the relay location and the faulty point. So that it will take action, is what is called a impedance relay. I told you, since impedance of transmission line can be considered to be directly proportional to distance, so that the type of relay is what is called a distance relay. So another name of distance relay is what is called a impedance relay. Because as it designed, based on the distance of transmission line. So it is what is called a impedance relay. Next. Directional relay. What do you mean directional relay? For example, you have a transmission line. So you have a relay on one particular location. If the fault occurs at back side of relay, it will not respond. Understand? Are you understood? There is a transmission line, you have a relay here. So if the fault occurs at backward direction, this relay will not take action. So directional relay will responsible for fault occurs in the forward direction. So if the fault is in front of me, then I will take action. If the fault is at the back side of me, I will not take action. Is what is called a directional relay. So it will take action depends on the direction of current flow. If the current flow is forward, this relay will take action. If the current flow is reverse, it will not take action. Is what is called a directional relay. This is most widely used in transmission line and busbar protection. This overcurrent relay basically have two type of setting. Okay, relay means what? Is what are the important information about the relay? Yes. See here. This is the current from the transmission line given to the overcurrent relay as it is having the signal to the circuit breaker. Okay. Now it has two type of setting. One is what is called a plug setting. Other is what is called a time setting. So what do you mean? Plug setting means the plug setting multiplier means if the value of plug setting. See here, I relay by plug setting. So you are setting the value of relay current. Okay, you are setting the value of relay current. So if the current is greater than 1, this relay will provide the trip signal. If the current is less than 1, it will not take any action. So you have to set the value of relay. It's called a pickup value. So if you buy relay from the market, you can find the pickup value. So it has to be designed based on the pickup value. This B is what is called a plug setting. setting multiplier. Okay, it's another one is what? Time setting. And the time setting means what? How fast the relay is taking action. Okay, how fast relay is taking action. So that depends on time setting. So time setting should be very low value or it should be high value. Time setting should be very low value. Why the time setting should be very low? The severity of the fault is very important. So if the fault is very severe, relay should take action immediately. Because if the fault is very severe, if the relay is not taking action immediately, then what happens? Immediately your entire system is going to be collapsed. So severity of the fault must be inversely proportional to time setting. Fault is severe, time setting should be very low value. If the fault is normal, time setting should be in the order of seconds, no problem. So the time setting must be in the order of microseconds. So that it should immediately sense the fault current and it will give trip signal to the circuit breaker. Otherwise, your entire system is going to be collapsed. Okay? So two settings are very important in the overcurrent relay. That's it. Yeah. You can find here. You can find here.
Yeah. See here. If the current value is very high, when the current value is very high, when the fault is
severe, fault.
So when the fault is severe, operating time should be what? Within this value. So the current value is very high, operating time should be minimum. So it is having the inversely proportional. So if the fault is here, then what is the time? Very high time. Understand? So severity of the fault means response time of the relay should be very minimum. That is the information about this relay. Yeah, next. And the drawback of overcurrent relay is what? The reach and the operating time of overcurrent relay depends on magnitude of fault current. I told you. I mean, if the fault current is very high, it should take action. And the fault current that would result in the case of fault at a particular location, that is very important. So where the fault occurs in the power system? I mean, whether the type of fault. Basically, two type of fault. One fault is what? For example, the transmission line is grounded. Now what happens? This line will be cut due to insulation failure. So this live wire will be falling on the ground. It is what is called a short circuit fault. And another fault is what? These two conductors are cut, kept open circuit. Is what is called the open circuit fault. So the ground of the overcurrent relay, it also depends on type of fault. Either it may be an open circuit fault or short circuit fault. This will respond only for short circuit fault. It can't respond for open circuit fault. Okay? Next is the source impedance. I told you. Another relay is what? Distance relay. Distance relay, it measures voltage and current in the fault location, then it will find the impedance. So that it will provide the ring of security. Is what is called a distance relay. Yeah. If you can find, it will measure the impedance. Voltage divided by current, it will measure the impedance. So based on the value of impedance, it will take the action. Is what is called the impedance relay. Okay? So, also is very important, especially for transmission line protection. You can have an idea. So it forms the different zone of security depends on the value of R and X. So depends on the value of impedance, it forms different time zone. So that if the fault within that zone 1, it will trip. If the fault again at the zone 2, it will take action. So this is the characteristics of the distance relay. And it will go into this relay. And again, from this, the current is coming here. Now, what happened? If it is working under normal condition, then the spill current is zero. So, if the current is zero, this relay will not trip. But whenever there is a fault here, then the current difference here it will give signal to the relay. This is what is called a differential relay. So this relay is most suitably for equipment protection, especially for inter-turn fault in a transformer and alternators. This relay is most widely used. Okay, it can't be used for unit protection, equipment protection. Okay, this is used for unit protection, especially for transformer and alternators inter-turn protection. Yeah, you can find. What is the drawback of this relay? It cannot be responsible for smallest internal fault. Okay, it cannot be responsible for smallest internal fault. It is responsible only for severe, sudden rise in current. So if the multiple turns are interconnected, this relay will take action. If only one turn is shorter, this will not take action. That is the problem of differential relay. And this idea is difficult to achieve, especially for very heavy throw fault. If whole winding is going to be, bumped due to internal fault, this relay will not respond. So this relay neither suitable for smallest fault nor suitable for heavy fault. It will be suitable for only intermediate fault. Okay, that is the problem of differential relay. Next, another relay is what is called a directional relay. I told you the directional relay, it will provide the trip signal whenever there is a current flows in the forward direction. If the current flows in the backward direction, this relay will not respond. This is what is called a directional relay. This is most widely used in the transmission line. It never be used for transformer or alternator protection. Okay? Yeah. Yes, next one. Yeah, you can find here. So, now what happened? Here, generator 1 and generator 2. These two are interconnected via bus 1, bus 2 with this different time zone. Now what happened? If the fault is here, there are two relays. Here, R13 relay, here R31 relay. If the fault occurs here, only these two relays will take action. These relays will not take action. Please understand. Because if the fault is here, current flow is forward direction, so that this relay will trip. But if the fault is here, this relay will not take action. So if the fault is here, then who will take action? If the fault is here, then either R12 or R21 will take action. This relay remains operational. So this is what is called a directional relay. So it will trip whenever there is a current flow in the forward direction. Understand? This is what is called a differential relays. Next. Yeah. As I told you, various protection in power system basically having directional overcurrent, directional differential overcurrent, distance protection, become a different equipment. Alternators, busbar, transformers, transmission line, and large induction motor. So accordingly, we can design the different type of protections here. Yes. If you want to protect that alternator, you can use either directional overcurrent or differential or distance. You can use these three for alternator. If it is a busbar protection, you can use only differential protection. I told you. So differential protection is only suitable for busbar protection. And next come to the transformer, we can use only differential protection. So current entering and leaving are different, then this relay will operate. You cannot use any other protection for transformers. And again, transmission line, either you use directional overcurrent relay or distance relay. As the distance of a transmission line depends on impedance. Or if you use a large induction motor, either you can use differential relay or directional, non-directional overcurrent relay. Okay? So these are the different zone of protection and a different overcurrent protection scheme used in power system. Okay? Differential protection, distance protection, directional protection, these all are coming under overcurrent protection. Okay? So in that way, you can design the relay for different operations, and accordingly, you can prevent any abnormal conditions happens in the power system. Okay? Next. So in the overall, as you studied about the circuit breakers and the essence of protection, and also you have given a hint about overcurrent protections, differential, distance, directional attack. Okay.
I hope you understand a bit about the power system protection. So if you have any doubt, anything else, let us discuss. Then after you can go for lunch. Yeah. Any doubts?